Hello, everyone, and good evening. I want to welcome you to the March Your Child's Health University Lecture entitled What Every Parent Needs to Know About Children and Headaches. I'm Felice Stonestrom, and I coordinate the community programs here at Packard Children's Hospital. And just a reminder before we get started, this lecture is being videotaped, so we ask that you hold all of your questions to the very end, at which point we will turn off the cameras and you can ask questions anonymously. So it's my great pleasure to introduce our speaker tonight, Dr. Susy Jeng. Dr. Jeng is Clinical Assistant Professor of Neurology at Lucile Packard Children's Hospital at Stanford University. She received her BA at Harvard College and MD at the University of California, San Diego. She completed her pediatrics residency at University of California, San Francisco, and is board certified in pediatrics. After practicing general pediatrics for 2 years, Dr. Jeng returned to UCSF for neurology residency. Upon completion of her residencies, she joined the faculty at Stanford as a general child neurologist with a special interest in medical education and complex care. Dr. Jeng currently serves on the long-range planning committee of the Child Neurology Society and is a member of the American Academy of Neurology. She is also a member of the editorial board for the Federal Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality's WebMNM website. Thank you, Dr. Jeng.
Thank you, Felice. So I'm here to talk about what every parent needs to know about children and headaches. So I think a very common topic. First, I need to start by saying I have no financial disclosures or relationships. I do tend to discuss some unapproved uses of medications, mainly because a lot of medications are used off-label in pediatrics. So why are we here and why are we talking about this? By age 15, 80% of boys and 84% of girls will have complained of a headache. So it is a very, very common complaint. And as parents, you're always wondering, what do I do with that information? So I thought I would kind of bring it home, make it relevant, by showing a little video of my own daughter, who is in preschool. She just turned 5. And I just sat her down, and I didn't prep her. I just asked her to tell me a little bit about her headaches. So
a headache is basically the same as a stomach ache, but it's your head.
Yeah, what does your head feel like?
Like you want to bang it on something.
Oh, and what do you think causes a headache?
Not sure.
Yeah. What makes your headache feel better?
Water.
Oh, good. Sounds good. Any other things about headaches, about your headaches? No? Hey, so kids think about their headaches, at least when I forced her to think about it, she told us what she thought. And so what I'm going to cover today, I don't know why I keep forwarding for some reason, but the first question we really all want to know is it a dangerous thing? Is the headache a dangerous sign? And so we want to exclude ominous headaches. And once we kind of take that off, then the bulk of the talk really will be about, is it migraine? And we'll talk about why migraine is the next thing we often go to. And then talking about optimizing non-medication techniques. I think we all agree that we'd rather kids not take medication if we can help it. And then if we do need to go to medication, what are our immediate treatment options for headache? And then importantly, how do we prevent headaches in children? So the first part of any evaluation for headaches is to exclude ominous headaches or concerning headaches. We call those secondary headaches. So we start with a very, very detailed history and physical examination. And from that, we may need to do some imaging studies or other studies. And then we get to the two, which is the benign primary headache or the structural pathologic secondary headache. That would be the ominous ones. So under a benign primary headache, the main ones are migraine, tension headaches, and something called chronic daily headache, which is, of course, not all that descriptive. And the way to distinguish between them is really by history. And so we'll talk about those later. And then when we talk about structural headaches, we're really concerned about a mass lesion, so something that's actually in the brain, like a tumor or a bleed or something like that, or an illness, so a meningitis or an infection in the brain. Those are things we want to make sure are not happening. So when we want to exclude ominous headaches, there are some history findings and exam findings that are characteristic of headaches due to brain tumors. So the font might be a little bit small here, but the first one is severe incapacitating pain, so often increasing in frequency or severity. That, of course, is not exclusive to secondary headaches. Migraines can also be incapacitating and severe, but that is a little bit of a red flag. The second would be a headache that occurs without any history of previous headache or some significant changes in their headache pattern. The third would be vomiting that's persistent, increasing in frequency, or preceded by a recurrent headache. Again, not exclusive to secondary headaches because migraine can also cause vomiting. But if you have that added piece, you want to think a little bit more seriously about secondary headaches. Oftentimes, structural or mass lesion headaches will be localized to the front or the back of the head, often in a focus spot rather than sort of the whole head. These types of headaches can awaken you from sleep, or you have a lot of pain when you first wake up, and that's probably related to the fact that having a structural thing in your head can increase the pressures inside your head. And if you're lying down all night and those pressures equalize, you actually have an increased pressure in your head from lying down, and so you might have a worsening headache at that point. And then similarly, worse with Valsalva-like maneuvers. So Valsalva maneuvers are when you increase pressure inside of your body or your head, such as coughing or bearing down, that'll increase pressure. So headaches that are worsened by that are significant. And then if there's no family history of migraine, that's something to take into account. And then obviously, if there's any neurologic findings on the examination. So that is from a paper that's quoted below associated with brain tumor headaches. So then this is an interesting fact. So brain tumor headaches are associated with neurologic findings. So papilledema is swelling of the optic nerves, eye movement problems, weakness, balance problems, so neurologic findings. In 85% of cases within 8 weeks of when the headache starts, and in virtually all cases by 24 weeks, so approximately 6 months. So if a headache has been going on for a year unchanged in its characteristics, that might be a bit more reassuring or more reflective of a primary headache problem. Not always the case, but a guideline. Okay. And this is a picture of, obviously, a brain tumor. Okay, and then some more pictures. So this is a picture from the web of an eye movement abnormality. If you can see on that right eye, there's an esotropia, so the eye is turned in, so the alignment problem. This is a cute picture one of my colleagues found. So a girl with, you can see her left eye is up, and her doll also has a hypertropia as well. So... All right, so excluding ominous headaches, so the history, a lot of this has to do with taking a very detailed history. And so the first part of it is really talking about the pain, the attributes of it. So when, can you identify that it started on a particular day at a certain time? Is it particularly at a time of day when they first wake up from sleep, or is it when they're at school only? Is it less on the weekends? Those kinds of things. And then provocative or palliative features, so things that might make it better or might make it worse, those can give you clues as to what kind of headache it is. The quality of the pain, so even really young kids can tell you if it feels like something sharp, like a needle poking, versus something that's throbbing, like your heart, or a pressure that someone's pushing on your head. So those can help distinguish as well. And then you want to ask about the location of the pain. Is it always only on one side of the head? Is it always only in one place? Those are helpful. And then the severity of the pain, the scale of 0 to 10, and are the headaches, where are they on that scale? And then the pattern over time, so recurrent, progressive, non-progressive. So there are a lot of questions that get asked during these evaluations. And then we don't just ask about headache, we ask about associated features, so nausea, vomiting, abdominal pain, visual symptoms like blurry vision, flashing lights, holes in your vision, double vision, so seeing two of things, whether there's only one or overlapping, vertigo, which is the sensation of everything rocking around you or moving around you, or dizziness, which is sort of more nonspecific, but can mean feeling like you're going to faint, as opposed to the vertigo feeling. And motion sickness, that's a big one, actually. So on physical exam, this is a very exhaustive physical exam. You might not do all of these things, but based on the history, these are things that you could certainly think about in evaluating for headache. So you definitely need the vital signs, blood pressure and temperature, if you're looking for infection or sinus infections, the size of the head, inspection of the skull, listening for abnormal blood vessels over the neck, over the temples, over the eyes, inspection of the mouth and the jaw. So these are talking about referred pain, pain from structures in the skull or in the face that become referred as headache, because they're processed, those pain signals are processed through the same parts of the brainstem. And then inspection of sinuses, inspection of the spine, including the neck, checking at all ranges of the motion of the neck, and then a complete neurologic examination. So in terms of laboratory investigations, we might want to do brain imaging if there's focal symptoms. So it's always, the pain is always on one side, or there's an abnormal neurologic exam that's only on one side. Any new or progressive disorder, we would consider getting brain imaging. And any symptoms of increased pressure inside of the head, we would certainly want to get imaging for that. A lumbar puncture, which is when you put a needle into the fluid space around the spinal cord, could be helpful if you're looking for infection or inflammation, because that fluid that's around the spinal cord also circulates up into around the brain, so it's the same fluid, and it also actually has the same pressure. So if you're looking for increased pressure inside the head, a lumbar puncture can give you the pressure inside the head without having to put a needle up here. And then neck x-rays are rarely helpful in evaluating headache. So this is just an example of a structural problem that you would find on MRI. So this is a side view of an MRI scan of a brain, and the nose is over here, the mouth is over here. This is the front of the brain, and this line here is showing the opening at the bottom of the skull, so that the brain is above the opening and the spinal cord should be below. And here you can see part of the brainstem and the cerebellum, which is this part of the brain, are below the opening. And that's called a Chiari 1 malformation. Many times, this is actually relatively common, 1% in the population. And many people are asymptomatic. They don't have any symptoms ever, or some will develop them in adulthood. But oftentimes, you can imagine they will complain of pain in the back of their head or pain with coughing or bearing down. So that's one thing you can catch when you're doing imaging for headache. So basically, we tried to exclude ominous headaches with our history, our physical exam, any other studies we wanted to do. And so if we can take that off the table, the next question really is it migraine? So primary headache disorders. Dr. Raskin, who's one of the fathers of headache at UCSF, he said that there's a continuum of benign, so not dangerous, acute, sudden, and recurrent headache. And the main ones we talk about are tension headache, migraine without aura, which is defined as common migraine with aura, which is classic migraine, and chronic daily headaches. And the take-home point really is that these headache disorders are not dangerous, but they are extremely painful. They can be very painful and debilitating, causing kids to not even be able to go to school for weeks at a time. So they are painful, and it's important to validate that. And just to illustrate that, this is my daughter's drawing of her with a headache in her bed. Her head's on the pillow, and she's got a headache. If you remember from the video, she was talking about wanting to pound her head against the wall. Of course, she wouldn't do that, but that's how it feels. So is it migraine? So it occurs. Migraine occurs in 43% of women, 18% of men, about 4% of girls, and 5% of boys. I've heard people say that their pediatrician said kids can't have migraines, and that's certainly not true. Migraines most commonly start in adolescence. They can start any time, but most commonly in adolescence. And so as pediatric neurologists, we see a lot of kids with first-time headache. It is often hereditary, and the way to sort of think about it is that it's migraine brain, or a hyper-excitable type of brain. We'll talk about that a little bit more later. Likely from a combination of hereditary factors as well as triggers in their lives that kind of kick off the migraines. And the thing that can be tough for some parents is that there is no test to diagnose migraines. No blood test, no imaging test. The test will usually look normal, so it's a diagnosis of exclusion and by history. This is kind of a very busy slide, talking about our incomplete understanding of what causes migraines. This article is from the New England Journal of Medicine in 2002. So there's an idea that there's some type of neural trigger which causes dilation, so opening up of blood vessels that are either supplying the brain or supplying the membranes of the brain. And then that dilation feeds back into the brainstem, which monitors that, and that causes a depression of blood flow to the brain and depression of brain activity. And then that feeds back to dilate the blood vessels some more. And there's a dysfunction of these brainstem pathways that take in these inputs from the blood vessels and bring them up to the brain, such that it sort of becomes a self-perpetuating cycle. And snowballs. And so the key pathway for this perception of pain is what is called the trigeminal vascular input. So the trigeminal nerve is the one that takes all of the input from the head and the skull, the face, the front of the head, I should say, and processes that. And so there's a thought that this is kind of what's underlying it. Okay. So some key points talking about adult migraine versus childhood migraine. It's not always as classic in children, so it's important to know that in adult migraine, often it's more prominent in women. In childhood, actually pretty equal, but about 60% in boys. In adults, it's episodic, so it isn't occurring all the time. Often one-sided, recurrent, and pulsatile, often in the front or over the temples. And adults often have visual symptoms. So blurry vision is probably the most common, but as we said, blind spots, even blindness, jagged lines over minutes to hours. And then they do have, some adults will have warning symptoms with weakness or numbness, and those are aura symptoms. To be called a migraine in an adult, it has to last from between 4 to 72 hours. Although those definitions aren't exact, and often with nausea, vomiting, sensitivity to light and sound, or a desire to go to sleep, so fatigue, and that sleep often will help migraines. So that's sort of the classic pattern in adult migraine. In kids, these aura-type symptoms are as you can see in the middle, preceding signs are more often irritability, pallor, fatigue, loss of appetite, less likely to be a visual or sensory or weakness kind of symptoms, although some kids will complain of those as well. Often there's a minor head trauma that kicks things off. So you might not even identify it unless sort of pressed and thinking back to the few days before the headache. The headache is less often just one-sided, often bilateral. And the attacks are often much shorter, so only minutes to hours instead of hours to days, which makes medication sometimes difficult to know if it works or not since their headaches are so brief. 45% have a past history of motion sickness. There's an increased incidence of sleep disorders in these kids, and overall a more favorable prognosis than in adults. So just speaking about motion sickness, another drawing here of cars. And over here is, you can see this car over here. I think that's supposed to be me driving. That's the steering wheel. And this is my daughter sitting in the back of the car with a frown because she has a headache. So her motion sickness manifests with a headache and nausea. And these days with kids always sitting in the back and sometimes even facing backwards, you can imagine that's not great for migraineurs. Okay, so then questions that we ask the parents and the family and the children, are there any warning symptoms? Do you have to stop what you're doing when you have your headaches? That can sometimes distinguish a migraine. You just can't perform a tension headache. You might be able to push your way through. Does the pain occur at any special time under certain circumstances? What do you think is causing your headaches? That's getting at triggers, if there's certain triggers that might be kicking off their headaches. Any past history of even mild trauma, and any family history of migraine. And then, so this is important because sometimes we have difficulty with treatment, the treatments aren't working, and it might be because they have different kinds of headaches. So the same child may have a migraine type headache. They may also have a primary stabbing headache, which is a feeling of sharp needles jabbing into their temples. And that primary stabbing headache is a different disorder, but is more common in kids with migraine and is treated differently. So when a child says their headaches aren't better, it's important to make sure that they're, which headaches are we talking about? And then in asking the questions about is it throbbing, does it cause vomiting, you want, really want to ask when your headache is bad, because they might not bring up the symptoms during a regular headache. Okay. So moving on to talking about treatment. So a very key part of this is looking at non-pharmacologic techniques and optimizing those. The first step is really reassurance. I think just knowing that the neurologist doesn't think that your child has a dangerous headache is a first step. It's very reassuring. And validation, because it's still extremely painful and debilitating, even if it's not dangerous per se. And then parent or patient education. So we talk about a headache diary or a headache calendar. Sometimes it's really hard to identify triggers or identify relationship, what time of day or things like that, medication efficacy, without really having a headache diary that you keep track and then you bring into your doctor to look at. And then general non-pharmacologic treatments, we'll go over these in more depth in a little bit. So definitely avoidance of headache triggers. That you've identified from your diary. A headache diet can be helpful for some. Sleep regulation is key. Going to bed, waking up at the same time every day, during the weekends, during the week. Daily exercise has been shown in studies to be very effective in helping with chronic migraines. Alcohol abstinence, depending on the age, and considering discontinuation of oral contraceptives if you see a relationship between that and the migraines. That is sort of person dependent. There's not good literature supporting that in all cases. And then after talking about some of those general treatments, I'll also mention some specific non-pharmacologic treatments. So common triggers just to think about in your child would be stress and anxiety. So you may not think that kids have a lot of stress in their lives, but when you look at these kids during the summertime, their headaches often are much better than during the school year. So there's got to be some stress there with school. Also menstruation, oral contraceptives, physical exertion can actually be a trigger if you're not used to exercising regularly. Lack of sleep, schoolwork, relationships, and that's also talking about the relationships in the family, the relationship between the parents, how much fighting is going on. I've seen more sort of fighting around financial issues recently with the economy, and that takes its toll on kids too. Glare, weather changes, high altitude. So in this population here, oftentimes it's when they go up to Tahoe, and then they complain of their headaches being much worse. Refractive error, so making sure their vision's okay. Drugs, talking about some of the kids that have other medical problems that are on a lot of drugs. Fasting and certain foods. Okay, so this is not a complete list, but the ones I usually talk about with parents are MSG. That can be a really big one for people. Sodium nitrates, nitrites and nitrates, so processed meats. Those can actually be a big trigger. And then the caffeine variety. So everyone knows about coffee, but iced teas, yeah, also with caffeine, or theophylline. And all these energy drinks often have caffeine in them, and kids don't even look at the label and don't realize that. And then even some pain relievers can actually be triggers for migraines. So just kind of touching back on that contraceptive use, some people have tried to use them actually to treat migraine. There's no convincing evidence that they improve migraines. In some people, it does improve them. In some, it makes it worse. And it may exacerbate or change the pattern of them as well. One warning is that it should be used in caution in women with migraines with aura, so with visual symptoms or sensory or weakness symptoms. And the reason for that is that with oral contraceptives, the risk of stroke in young women is higher. It's 1 to 3 per 10,000 cases per year. And then in patients with migraine without aura who are on OCPs, it goes from 1 to 3 to about 11 per 10,000, which is still not that high. And then migraine with aura with oral contraceptives is about 23 out of 10,000. So it's a significant thing to talk about with your patients. And the caveat is that nowadays, so those numbers are from when the OCP, the levels of the hormones were much higher. So we think that with these lower formulations that there's a lower risk of stroke. So in terms of specific treatments, I think at every headache visit you should talk about identifying the stressors and figure out from the family whether there has been any counseling or psychotherapy. It seems that a lot of these children, their parents say they're the type of kid who holds things in. They may not be outwardly depressed or anxious, but a lot of times you really have to have that part of the treatment in order to get a breakthrough with the headache therapy. Even on medications, you also need the therapy on the psychotherapy on the other side. Other treatments include biofeedback, relaxation therapies, imagery, guided imagery, physical therapy, hypnosis, meditation, yoga, and acupuncture. I've done some literature searches, and there's not enough evidence to give recommendations in the practice guidelines. But if parents and kids are interested, I don't see any downsides of doing these things, and certainly they can reduce stress. Okay, so we've moved now past trying to eliminate triggers and identify stressors, And now we're talking about immediate treatment options. So there's sort of two categories of immediate treatment. So the one that everybody knows about are analgesics, so pain medications. And the other category is abortive treatments. So abortive means to try and halt the process of something that's going on. So abortive treatments for migraine would be medicines that you would take right away to try and stop the migraine or halt the migraine. So in terms of pain medications, we have Tylenol and Advil. Those two have been around a long time and are approved in children, and that's pretty much it that's officially approved. Other ones that people will try are, for example, naproxen or Aleve has great research in adults. Ketorolac is like an IV form of Advil. Then we have prochlorperazine or Compazine, which is a medicine for nausea and vomiting, but works on some of the migraine centers of the brainstem. And then the ones beneath that, so furanol, codeine, and that category, those are barbiturates and opiates. And while they can be helpful, the risk is for overuse, for abuse. So I have never prescribed those in children. And then lastly, butorphanol is related to that. And then corticosteroids, so things like prednisone, have been used as a short burst to try and break a headache. The problem is that there's a strong rebound effect, such that when you stop the steroids, the headache can come back or be worse. So again, really Tylenol and Advil are the first line. There are a couple others, ergotamines, caffeine, something called Midrin, metoclopramide, which is also Reglan, also known as Reglan. It's a medication to help the motility of your GI, your gastrointestinal tract, but can also help with migraine because you actually have a slowdown in your motility with migraine. And then the big category is triptans. You may have heard of them, sumatriptan or Imitrex, and then a whole line of other ones, zolmitriptan, Alma, Riza, Nera, Frova. So they really had variations on a theme here. The Imitrex or sumatriptan is the only one that had really been studied at the time of the big practice parameter for pediatric headache in 2004. Okay, so why triptans? It was the first medication designed specifically for migraine treatment. Everything else was just sort of found in passing to be helpful with headache and migraine. And the idea is serotonin, also known as 5-HT, is a neurotransmitter. A neurotransmitter is a molecule that transmits signals from a nerve cell to a target cell. And so the nerve cell sends out the serotonin, the target cell has a receptor for serotonin on it. And serotonin receptor 5-HT1B was found to be on blood vessels that supply the brain and skull. So if you activate that receptor, it causes the blood vessels to constrict. Another thought why serotonin can help is it may also block this pain signaling cycle, possibly through another receptor, which is 5-HT1D. So this is another picture from that New England Journal article in 2002, and it's showing sort of these are the blood vessels that are running in the layers covering the brain, and they have receptors, they have receptors for 5-HT1B on them, and then there's also receptors for 5-HT1D on the neuron that senses, that gets signals from the blood vessels when they dilate or constrict, and that goes back into the brainstem, and then the central neuron here, which modulates the signals from those peripheral neurons, also has 5-HT receptors. And at the start of a migraine, blood serotonin levels do drop. And so initially they found that if you give serotonin, it can stop an attack. But serotonin can have a lot of side effects, that it has actions on many other parts of the body. And so triptans were a modification of the serotonin molecule that has fewer side effects. It's more specific to only the 5-HT1B and the 1D. So talking about specific ones, sumatriptan or Imitrix is the one most people know about. It, of course, vasoconstricts. It constricts the blood vessels. It comes as a shot under the skin, a nasal, and oral. Possible side effects, I usually warn people about a possible feeling of chest tightness or pain. There can be issues with cardiac rhythm problems as well, and should be used in caution with patients with cardiac problems. That being said, they have used them, and there have been very few reported cases of any problems. So effective in children over age 8, the label of approval is they need to be 12 for approval. And then just speaking of approved triptan, so this is since 2004. The guidelines were in 2004. There's amitriptan, and that's been approved for teenagers with migraines lasting over 4 hours. So starts acting a little bit later, but it lasts for longer compared to Imitrix. Maxalt or rizatriptan for children over age 6. And zolmitriptan or Zomig, which comes both orally and nasally, and the nasal one is approved in children over 12. So the caveat for what we say approved, it's approved, for it to be approved, it's not that the other ones have a lot of side effects or problems, but the problem is that pediatric migraines are often shorter, and it can be hard with a placebo effect. So often the kids will feel better in less than 4 hours, even without medication. So to prove efficacy, to say that a triptan works in the background of so many kids who have improved on their own is very difficult to establish. So that's why there's some difficulty with approval. And then just to mention some other triptans that may be studied in kids in the future, elotriptan, which is the most effective one in adults, frovatriptan, which is the longest acting, and naratriptan. Okay. So moving on to preventing headaches. The first part I like to talk about is just calming down the hypersensitive brain. So we've talked about how there's this feedback loop of ever escalation between the blood vessels and the brainstem and the cortex. And the idea is that we just want to calm things down. So preventative medications, we think about them if a child has 6, 7 or more migraines a month. The main reason for that number is because if you're taking those abortive medications, Advil, Tylenol, more than 2 or 3 times a week, over a month basis, you can actually get medication overuse headache from those medications. And so you get into a sticky situation there. And that's why we would think about preventative medications, which don't give you a medication overuse headache. The idea with them is you take a little bit every week, you go up a little bit, and it slowly builds up in the body. If you go up slowly, you minimize side effects, and once it builds up in the body, it raises the threshold at which you have a migraine. So they do not work right away. They don't stop a migraine if it starts. It just lowers your body, raises your brain's tolerance so that you're less likely to have migraines overall. And so you have to take them every day, even if you're headache-free on some days. And that can be a hard concept to get through, but these are preventatives. So regardless if you have a headache or not, you got to take them every day and build them up in your system. And the goal is not necessarily no headaches at all with these, but hopefully a 50% or more reduction in headache frequency, such that perhaps you could take 1 or 2 days, you could take a abortive therapy. So in the practice parameters, they say, for a clinical problem so prevalent in children and adolescents, there is a disappointing lack of evidence from controlled, randomized, and masked trials. So most of the recommendations that we make are based on adult trials and also sort of practical experience. Again, 84% of kids complain of headache at some point, so we certainly have a lot of kids with headache. And this is a photo of my daughter, both to remind me to, or both because of the disappointment at the lack of randomized controlled trials. And actually, it's her face I asked her to make when how she feels when she has a migraine. So that's her headache or migraine face. And then there are a lot of preventative medications. Again, there are no recommendations for in the pediatric parameters for these, but these are based on adult and experience. The big ones that I usually talk about are anti-epileptics, Topamax or topiramate, antidepressant, amitriptyline or Elavil, antihistamine, cyproheptadine. That's usually in younger children because it can cause a lot of sleepiness, which can interfere with school. And then antihypertensives, propranolol or Inderal. So as you can see, none of these medications were designed initially for headache. They all have other purposes and were found to modulate migraines. And the decisions regarding these are really based on side effect profile. It's difficult to identify which one is going to work in which patient. Okay. And then vitamins and supplements. So none have been sufficiently studied in children. But in adults, there are actually some guidelines and good evidence for some of these supplements. So riboflavin or vitamin B2, 400 milligrams daily. Magnesium, 300 to 600 milligrams daily. And this new one, pedicites or butterbur, 50 to 75 milligrams twice daily. That one actually has the strongest randomized controlled trial evidence in adults, but is also one of the newer ones to be studied. So, talking about why does headache treatment fail with the tougher cases, maybe the diagnosis was incomplete or incorrect. Important factors have been missed, such as caffeine or abortive medication overuse, hormonal triggers, dietary or lifestyle triggers, psychosocial factors, as we talked about, the need for counseling or psychotherapy, or other medications. And then oftentimes, the amount of medication has not been adequate. So the dosing has been off, or the how often they're using it. They think they just use it when they have their headache, when really it's a preventative medication. Inadequate duration of treatment. So I used it once, but then my kid felt tired, so I stopped using it. Versus you really have to give it a week or two. Those side effects often get better. Or just non-compliance. And then sometimes the non-pharmacologic treatment, so talking about things like needing regular exercise or counseling, those treatments have been inadequate. So this was a paper where they looked at refractory patients and tried to identify what were the things that made them refractory. And this last slide is, that was the previous one was her when she had a headache, and this is when she does not have a headache. So this is our goal for all of our kids. And with that, I'm open for questions. Thank you.